apocryphal Acts are an interesting body of literature because though non-canonical and in many ways theologically heretical, the stories from these texts became used by Orthodoxy for collections of Lives of the Saints, which would be read on the festival day of each of the saints. The Lives tapped into a need among people for an expanded pantheon of godlike beings like the Greek and Roman gods of old. Though not every Christian denomination finds such figures and such tales appealing, Protestant Christianity considers veneration of saints idolatry. But you do see it in Catholicism, Greek and Roman Orthodox Christianity, Coptic Christianity, etc. These groups love the stories, and it's largely due to their efforts to keep copying out the manuscripts of Apocryphal Acts and reusing the stories from these texts that we have the texts at all. We'll begin with a brief look at the canonical book of Acts to give us some context for the apocryphal texts. Acts is part two of the Gospel of Luke and draws upon various sources to continue the story of the church after Jesus' death. The first half of the book focuses on the apostles as a group, preaching and healing in Jerusalem. The last half focuses on Paul preaching outside Jerusalem to Gentiles. The text finishes with Paul in Rome. The goal is to show that the Christian message has come to the center of the world, the capital. At the beginning, Jesus appears and gives the apostles a mission. He says to them, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." And that's precisely the story that the book of Acts tells. There's one interesting story in here that I want to highlight, and this happens in Samaria. And here the apostle Philip encounters a local holy man named Simon. Here's just a part of the story. It says, now in that city was a man named Simon, who had been practicing magic and amazing the people of Samaria, claiming to be someone great. All the people, from the least to the greatest, paid close attention to him, saying, "This man is the power of God that is called great." And they paid close attention to him because he had amazed them for a long time with his magic. But when they believed Philip as he was proclaiming the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they began to be baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed, and after he was baptized, he stayed close to Philip constantly. And when he saw the signs and great miracles that were occurring, he was amazed. Now Simon, when he saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, offered them money, saying, "Give me this power too, so that everyone I place my hands on may receive the Holy Spirit." But Peter said to him, "May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could acquire God's gift with money. You have no share or part in this matter, because your heart is not right before God. Therefore, repent of this wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that he may perhaps forgive you for the intent of your heart. For I see that you are bitterly envious and in bondage to sin." But Simon replied, "You pray to the Lord for me, so that nothing of what you have said may happen to me." Simon here is cast as a magician, and that's just something that groups in antiquity would do. Your holy man, your miracle worker is a holy man. Someone else's miracle worker is a magician. So just because Simon's called a magician doesn't mean he was one. He was a holy figure, a holy man for a particular form of a religion in antiquity. And here he's just being cast by a Christian as something that's negative. Whereas if you had read a text by someone who supported Simon, they would cast Christians as negative. So just be careful of that polemical view of magician. Even Jesus is called a magician in the Gospels by some of his enemies. So I mentioned Simon here because we'll encounter him again in some of the apocryphal Acts, particularly the ones on Peter. According to the canonical book of Acts, the growth of the church is steady and relatively smooth. It spreads out from Jerusalem, led by Peter and James. The Christians are opposed by outsiders, but the group dynamic is harmonious. Everyone seems to get along. But we're left with some questions about the origins of Christianity in some places. For example, the book of Acts talks about Samaria, talks about Jerusalem, talks about some other locations, but never mentions Christianity's origins in places like Alexandria and Syria. These were two very prominent locations for Christianity that began quite early, and Luke tells us nothing about them. It also doesn't say much about Christianity in Rome. There seems to have been a vital group there since the 40s, long before Paul gets there around the year 57. But Luke, again, doesn't say much about this. How do you explain this? Why talk about some groups and not others? Likely it has something to do with where the church is just around the year 70 or so, or shortly after the fall of the temple. Certain groups have started to come together, perhaps as a way of forming a united front against persecution. It's like modern ecumenical movements where Greek Orthodoxy and the Catholic Church are trying to come together and see what they actually agree upon. The Christianity of Luke's day seems to incorporate traditions of the Jerusalem Church, of Antioch, Samaria, Rome, and Pauline Christianity, but perhaps not Alexandrian and Syrian Christianity and some others. So beneath Luke's veneer, we get a sense that Christianity's growth was not so orderly at all. Nor was there complete agreement on all points, of practice and belief. I'll give you an example of the Noahic laws. In the text, Paul is called to Jerusalem to answer questions about his unsanctioned mission to the Gentiles. There's a debate about allowing Gentiles into the movement, and it's settled by James, the brother of Jesus, who's in charge of the Jerusalem church. He declares a bare minimum of rules for Gentiles coming into Christianity. So they don't have to follow the entire law, but they are told to follow what are referred to as the Noahic laws. These are rules given by God to Noah after the flood. And this is what is traditionally required of Gentiles in Jewish lands. So wherever Jews are in control of lands, the Gentiles, under their rule, would have to follow these few laws. Because this is what God said to all humanity after the flood. The significance here is that this was likely practiced by Luke's community, but was not retained by later Christianity. And it is kind of a concession. It's a way of saying, yes, we'll allow Gentiles in, but they have to do something. As Christianity developed, Gentiles didn't have to do anything. An interesting addendum to the book of Acts is a modern apocryphal text that claims to be the lost ending of Acts. In 1871, a book was published promising to provide the lost final chapter of Acts. According to the editor, it was translated in the late 18th century by the French naturalist Sanini de Manancourt from a manuscript discovered in the archives at Constantinople. It was found hidden in an English translation of Sanini's Voyage to Greece and Turkey in the library of Sir John Newport, an MP of the early 19th century after the MP's death. It's a pretty elaborate discovery story. Now, people have long thought that Acts should continue longer, particularly if the author of it, who we consider to be the Apostle Luke, was writing decades after Paul's death. Now, why didn't he say more about what happened to Paul? And Paul's letter to the Romans mentions that he wanted to go to Spain. However, we have never found any trace of a manuscript like Sanini's translated text, which continues the book of Acts. All we have is this one late published translation of what is purportedly a lost manuscript. And from reading this text, this lost chapter of Acts, we see that it's most likely to be a fraud. It just doesn't match with the interests of the first century, the language of the first century. But what does the text do? What does it try to explain? Well, it was used to support something called Anglo-Israelism, the belief that British people descended from a lost tribe of Israel. Let's read a couple portions of it for you. And Paul, full of the blessings of Christ and abounding in the Spirit, departed out of Rome, determining to go into Spain, for he had a long time proposed to journey thitherward, and was minded also to go from thence to Britain. For he had heard in Phoenicia that certain of the children of Israel, about the time of the Assyrian captivity, had escaped by sea to the isles afar off, as spoken by the prophet Ezra, and called by the Romans Britain. And the Lord commanded the gospel to be preached far hence to the Gentiles, and to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. The text goes on. And after much preaching and toil, Paul and his fellow laborers passed into Helvetia and came to Mount Pontius Pilate, where he who condemned the Lord Jesus dashed himself down headlong and so miserably perished. Immediately a torrent gushed out of the mountain and washed his body, broken into pieces, into a lake. And Paul stretched forth his hands upon the water and prayed unto the Lord, saying, O Lord God, give a sign unto all the nations that here Pontius Pilate, which condemned thine only begotten Son, plunged down headlong into the pit. And while Paul was yet speaking, behold, there came a great earthquake, and the face of the waters was changed, and the form of the lake like unto the Son of Man, hanging in an agony upon the cross. So this latter portion here is essentially a creation story for a particular lake that's connected to this to Pontius Pilate. So people could go journey to this lake and think about Pilate and Jesus and so on while they're there. So certainly this is a very late apocryphon. Some scholars would argue that it should not be included in courses like this or in Apocrypha collections. They don't like modern Apocrypha very much. But it is interesting for telling us about the interest in the late 19th century in manuscript discoveries, which were happening all the time, and in the British Israeli movement. Another modern apocryphon related to the Book of Acts is the long-lost second Book of Acts. This was self-published in 1904. The title page of the pamphlet describes it as setting forth the Blessed Mary's teachings about reincarnation, discovered and translated by Kenneth Sylvan Guthrie. Guthrie does not say what language this text was discovered in, nor in what manuscripts or editions this supposedly ancient text might be found. And it's clearly not an ancient text. In this work, Paul returns to Palestine, he doesn't go to Britain or Spain, and assembles with other apostles at the bedside of Mary. Now, if you've read The Dormition of Mary, this will sound familiar to you, this whole idea of assembling at her bedside. There, Mary expounds the teachings on reincarnation and declares the identities of her past lives. Then she leads all of the apostles to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus appears. He also states his previous incarnations and that Mary has loved him in all of them. And here they appear to have been consorts, and usually that would be Mary Magdalene, not Mary, the mother of Jesus, who would be consorts, so it gets a bit strange. Some of the previous incarnations of Jesus are Zarathustra and Socrates. Let's move on now to ancient apocrypha related to the Book of Acts. The earliest of these are referred to as the five great apocryphal Acts, Thomas, Andrew, Peter, Paul, and John. They were composed in the late 2nd to the 3rd century. But we also have a bunch of later texts written around the 4th to the 6th centuries. The Martyrdom of Matthew, the Acts of Philip, the Acts of Barnabas, the Acts of Mark, the Martyrdom of the Holy Apostle Ananias, etc. Some of these were assigned for the eClavis project. So a few of you have some knowledge of these already. The five great Acts have a lot of ideas and motifs in common, but were believed to have originally circulated independently of one another. But the early church fathers claimed someone named Lucius Quirinus wrote all of them. As a 5th or 6th century writer who says that Lucius was a disciple of John and he wrote apocryphal texts. Perhaps Lucius's name became attached to the entire corpus because his name was first on only one of these texts, the Acts of John. We don't actually have the entire Acts of John, so we can't judge if this is the case, but it's a possibility. The five texts were also brought together as a corpus in Manichaeism. This is a form of Gnosticism. And then we also have collections of apocryphal Acts that come later. There's a Latin compilation attributed to a person named Abdias, and there's an Ethiopic collection called the Contendings of the Apostles. And occasionally you get ad hoc collections and manuscripts, so various apocryphal Acts kind of join together. So they tend to attract themselves to one another, but it seems early on that they were independent texts, though they have some similar ideas in them. Each collects popular legends of the apostle and gives them a final form reflecting the interests of the writer. These interests are reflected in the behavior of the apostle and the speeches that he delivers in each of the texts. The apostle becomes an ideal and a mouthpiece for a particular kind of theology. His actions are to be a model for the reader's own conduct, and his speeches articulate the theology in which they are grounded. The texts usually begin with a commissioning story in which Jesus divides the world between the 12 apostles for missionary work. Here's one of these here's the commissioning story from the Acts of Thomas. It says, at that season, all we the apostles were at Jerusalem. Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the publican, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Canaanite, and Judas the brother of James. And we divided the regions of the world, and every one of us should go to the region that fell to him, and to the nation where the Lord sent him. So each apostle goes on his own particular missionary journey, teaches and heals, performs miracles, even more elaborate than those of Jesus. In casting the apostles this way, there may be a support here of the idea of the wandering charismatic, the way Christianity began, where people would roam around and preach and do miracles, perhaps being presented here against the increasing institutionalization of the church. So our writers of apocryphal Acts are writing how the church should be in their day by telling stories of how the church was in previous centuries. The teachings of the apostles in these texts are problematic because of the things that they say. They advocate extreme asceticism. The picture you see here is John leaving his betrothed for Christ, where he's reclining on Christ's breast at the Last Supper here. So all of our apostles practice ascetic lives. They don't have wives, they don't have sex, and they advocate that among the people that they are preaching to. The lessons that they give are usually occasioned by conversion of prominent women in the community. So the apostle would preach to these women, and they would become Christians, and then they would refuse to have sex with their husbands, and that sets up all sorts of social problems in the text. The prominence of women in these texts led a scholar named Stephen Davies to claim that they were written and transmitted by a community of Christian women. That is a possibility. Women in early Christianity could and did join Christianity to escape patriarchalism of contemporary society. These texts, Davies says, present roles for women to imitate. Other scholars have countered Davies' views, saying that the male disciples are still the main focus of the texts, and they often battle other men for authority over these women. The speeches also contain other things that are not particularly attractive to Orthodox Christians. Numerology, terminology, that's also found in Gnostic texts. Docetism, particularly in the Acts of John. So docetism showing Jesus as not being quite human. The texts also have other motifs, like elaborate journeys, folkloric elements like talking animals, deaths, and resuscitations. Scholars have noted similarities between these texts and the ancient novel, particularly the subgenre of romance. These novels also had journeys, deaths, and resuscitations, etc., and deal with the relationship between two lovers. Typically, these lovers are separated, and then they come back together at the end of the text. Acts may be a reaction to the romance novel, but the eroticism is directed to a spiritual union with Christ. So it's not about reuniting two lovers, though sometimes the interplay between the women and the apostle has kind of an erotic tinge to it. The text usually end with the apostle's death, the martyrdom of the apostle. The Apocrypha Acts also are rather long. You've only had to read segments of these excerpts, but they are quite lengthy texts and can get a bit tedious after a while. I'll talk a little bit about how to reconstruct the Apocryphal Acts. As the Roman Church gained prominence and determined which texts that they wished to consider scripture, the Apocryphal Acts presented them with a problem. The church liked the traditions about the apostles, particularly the miracles and the martyrdoms, but they didn't like the speeches, with all their Gnostic elements and so on, and the radical asceticism of the text. The church is moving away from that now that it was settled down in the world and was the original religion of the empire, so it's no longer about removal and not having children. So they edited the Apocryphal Acts in various ways to keep what they liked and get rid of what the things that they didn't like. It's up to scholars now to try and reconstruct the original texts. One really good way, examination of this is by Francois Bavon in an article called Editing the Apocryphal Acts of the Apostles. And he talks about how to go about reconstructing these texts, particularly for a text he was working on called the Acts of Philip. So where do we get all of our materials to reconstruct these texts? The martyrdoms are pretty easy to find. They were pretty much taken out of the Apocryphal Acts and kept intact. So we find lots of these martyrdoms and manuscripts. Sometimes we also find summaries of the rest of the text. So we'll get a martyrdom with a summary of the Apocryphal Acts that came before it. So we can use these summaries as kind of like a skeleton to reconstruct the original text. So there are a number of writers who did these summaries. These are versions by a 10th century writer named Simeon Metaphrastes. His summaries are quite well known, and I've been working with some of Metaphrastes' work, particularly in a text called The Acts of Cornelius that I put together for the More New Testament Apocrypha, Volume 1. So this tells the stories of Cornelius the centurion, who Peter converts to Christianity in the canonical book of Acts. We have also summaries in what are called menologia. This is a type of liturgical book used by the Greek Orthodox Church, and these feature extensive lives of saints to be read during the festivals for particular saints. So we look for menologia, and occasionally these menologia will contain what we call pre-metaphrastic material, so non-summarized material. So 1 out of 10 menologia contains material from the original Apocryphal Acts that's not in summary. And we also find stories outside of menologia, occasional stories here and there. Finally, we also have non-Greek versions of these Apocryphal Acts produced outside of the Christian world, so in Armenia, Syria, and Ethiopia. And these are less likely to have been revised, because in these areas, people were much more interested in the entire text of the Apocryphal Acts. So that's what we do. We get these summaries to give us a skeleton for what the text used to be. We find occasionally there's some stories here and there that we can plug into these skeletons, and then we have the versions in other languages, and we use all of that to try and reconstruct our text. And not all of the five original apocryphal acts are extant in full. The apocryphal acts of John, for example, we only have portions of still today. I think the Acts of Thomas is the only one that's complete. So it's a difficult process to figure out exactly what these texts contained. Let's begin our look through these texts. We'll begin with the Acts of Paul. The church writer Tertullian mentioned it around the year 200. And shortly after, Hippolytus in 204 mentions it, and Origen mentions it as well. And Origen mentions it favorably. He likes the text. So it's a text that only gradually became declared heretical. We don't have the entire text of the Acts of Paul. Erwin gives three portions of it, the martyrdom, the story of Thecla, and 3 Corinthians. And these may have once circulated independently and then got grafted together into this larger apocryphal Acts of Paul. Apparently it was written in Asia Minor somewhere around 185 to 195 by a presbyter who assembled the material out of love for Paul, he claimed. He was removed from office for it, and Tertullian mentions him. This is what he says. He says, to round off our slight treatment of this subject, it remains for me to advise you of the rules to be observed in giving and receiving baptism. The supreme right of giving it belongs to the high priest, which is the bishop. After him to the presbyters and deacons, yet not without commission from the bishop on account of the church's dignity. Except for that, even laymen have the right. But the impudence of that woman who assumed the right to teach is evidently not going to arrogate to her the right to baptize as well. So some woman thinks she can baptize and preach. Unless perhaps some new serpent appears like that original one, so that as that woman abolished baptism, some other should of her own authority confer it. But if certain acts of Paul, which are falsely so named, claim the example of Thecla for allowing women to teach and to baptize, let men know that in Asia the presbyter who compiled that document, thinking to add of his own to Paul's reputation, was found out, and though he professed he had done it for love of Paul, was deposed from his position. How could we believe that Paul should give a female power to teach and to baptize, when he did not allow a woman even to learn by her own right? Let them keep silence, he says, and ask their husbands at home. So Tertullian is one reaction to the text. He didn't like it, principally because people were using it to justify women teaching and baptizing. We may also have a reaction to the contents of Acts of Paul and Thecla in the canonical pastoral epistles. These are 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus that were written in Paul's name in the late 1st or early 2nd century. And Tertullian here is alluding to the content of that at the end of what he says in On Baptism. There's a scholar named Dennis R. MacDonald who has this theory about how the pastoral epistles and the Acts of Thecla relate to one another. He says the pastoral seize on Pauline views that call for stability in the household, but the Acts of Paul draws upon Paul's more ascetic views. In a sense, they are both equally correct in seeing the beginning of their ideas in Paul. So just to give you a few excerpts from the pastoral epistles that MacDonald thinks are kind of written in reaction to the content of the Acts of Paul and Thecla. So in 1 Timothy, the author writes, I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. Also that the women should dress themselves modestly and decently in suitable clothing, not with the hair braided or with gold, pearls, or expensive clothes, but with good works, as is proper for women who profess reverence for God. Let a woman learn in silence with full submission. I permit no woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She is to keep silent. For Adam was formed first, then Eve, and Adam was not deceived. But the woman was deceived and yet became a transgressor. Yet she will be saved through childbearing, provided they continue in faith and love and holiness with modesty. He goes on. She must be well attested for her good works as one who has brought up children, shown hospitality, washed the saints' feet, helped the afflicted, and devoted herself to doing good in every way, but refused to put younger widows on the list. For when their sensual desires alienate them from Christ, they want to marry, and so they incur condemnation for having violated their first pledge. Besides that, they learn to be idle, gadding about from house to house, and they are not merely idle, but also gossips and busybodies, saying what they should not say. So I would have younger widows marry, bear children, and manage their households, so as to give the adversary no occasion to revile us, for some have already turned away to follow Satan. And here's one excerpt from Titus. But as for you, teach what is consistent with sound doctrine. Tell the older men to be temperate, serious, prudent, and sound in faith, in love, and in endurance. Likewise, tell the older women to be reverent in behavior, not to be slanderers or slaves to drink. They ought to teach what is good, so that they may encourage the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be self-controlled, chaste, good managers of the household, kind, being submissive to their husbands, so that the word of God may not be discredited. So what MacDonald is saying here is that the Acts of Thecla circulated independently fairly early and was advocating for women to preach and to baptize and to be ascetics, to not settle down and have a husband and a household, etc. And these pastoral epistles, 1st and 2nd Timothy and Titus, were written by the church as it grew to be orthodoxy, that was more patriarchal and wanted women to have traditional household roles. So these texts seem to be in kind of conversation with one another, and all of them are really ascribed to Paul. The pastorals are written in Paul's name, but probably weren't written by him. And the Acts of Paul and Thecla, of course, work with Paul as a character to teach certain ideas. There's another effort to suppress the text of the Acts of Thecla and its legacy. This is a fresco from the Grotto of St. Paul in Ephesus. It's dated to around 6th century CE. This is a reconstruction of the fresco. What it looks like today is this. You see a figure, Paul, on the left, who has this particular kind of esoteric hand sign here, and a woman to the right who has the same hand sign, but it's scratched out, and her name is Theokalia, who you may remember is the name of Thecla's mother, and her eyes have been scratched out as well. And you'll notice that both figures are roughly around the same height. Height usually represents a figure's authority. Theokalia is a little taller here, but maybe Paul seems to be stooping a little bit. So I'm not sure if this is related necessarily to the Acts of Paul and Thecla at all, though it certainly has a character with the same name. But here we do have Paul and a woman on somewhat equal status, and someone has come along to this cave, this grotto, and decided that this view is unacceptable, and so has defaced the female character in the image. Before we move on to other apocryphal acts, I want to talk about some Pauline apocrypha, so texts written in Paul's name that are not in the Bible. First of these is the Epistle to the Laodiceans. This was created to fill in the canonical record of a Pauline letter mentioned in Colossians. So at the end of the letter, Paul says, after you have read this letter, have it read to the church of Laodicea. In turn, read the letter from Laodicea as well. But we don't have a text in the New Testament, a letter from Paul to the Laodiceans. The Moratorian canon mentions one that was apparently created by the Marcionites. They also wrote a letter to the Alexandrians in Paul's name, apparently. The epistle to the Laodiceans that we have now is probably not the same Laodiceans epistle, because it's not Marcionite in its view at all. It's actually very orthodox. And it's a very popular text. We even find it in some Latin Bible manuscripts. And it's probably composed somewhere around the 2nd to the 4th century. Scholars call it a worthless patching together of Pauline passages and phrases, mainly from the Epistle to the Philippians. And here's the text of the epistle here. And in this next slide, I've highlighted all of the material that's taken from Philippians. So it virtually is Philippians with a little bit of extra material here and there. So it's an interesting example of what I might call orthodox apocrypha. It's fully consonant with canonical Paul, practically is canonical Paul, and may have been composed to replace a Marcionite letter. So it's a way for the church to say, well, have you ever seen the letter of the Laodiceans that the Marcionites circulate? Well, here's the true letter to the Laodiceans, and it's very much like the Paul we have in the New Testament. Another Pauline pseudepigraphon is called the Correspondence Between Paul and Seneca. This was composed by the year 392 because Jerome mentions it in that year. And Jerome believed it to be authentic, and it was so. Other people believed so until the beginning of the Renaissance. But around the 15th century, people began to doubt its authenticity. Seneca was the most famous philosopher of his day, and he was an advisor to Nero. So I think an author here has decided that Paul, the greatest Christian philosopher of his day, should have had some discussions with Seneca, the greatest pagan philosopher of his day. But if you've read it, and you're supposed to read it, you'll notice they don't particularly say anything philosophical in this correspondence. So it's kind of meager in its contents as well. Two more texts. First of these is 3 Corinthians, which was originally part of the larger Acts of Paul, as I said, or may have originally circulated independently and then was brought into the Acts of Paul. It's written around the early 3rd century. We've looked at it a little bit early in this course. And it essentially argues against heretics, against Simon Magus, against Corinthus. And it articulates, again, a fully orthodox Paul in opposition to heretical views. And this text is particularly interesting because it formed part of the canon in the Eastern Church until the 5th century. So in Syria and Armenia, they had a 3rd epistle to the Corinthians in their canon. So all 3 of these, Laodiceans, Paul, and Seneca, and 3rd Corinthians, are quite orthodox in their view, and they bolster the canonical Paul. We have a final Pauline Apocryphon, which is more in line with the asceticism that we find in the Acts of Paul and the other apocryphal Acts. This is the pseudo-Titus epistle. So it's written by Titus, the apostle of Paul, to Paul. And it was discovered in 1896 in a Latin manuscript of the 8th century. The Latin is a translation from Greek made by a man with little knowledge of either language, so it's pretty tricky to read. But along the way in its discussion, it refers to various apocryphal acts and apocryphal apocalypses. So whoever wrote this liked all of these apocryphal texts. And it commends a life of chastity, just like the Apocryphal Acts does. It's a fairly lengthy text. I haven't asked you to read it, so consider yourselves lucky. It's likely composed around the 5th century. All right, let's return to the Apocryphal Acts with the Acts of John. As I said earlier, we don't have the entire Acts of John. We only have about 2/3 of it today. It was originally the length of the Gospel of Matthew, so fairly lengthy. So we reconstructed from numerous manuscripts with varying contents. It's set primarily in Ephesus in Asia Minor, which reflects the existing tradition that the apostle had been active in that region and had died in the city. We'll discuss the contents of the text in the chat later on, but I just wanted to draw your attention to one way the Acts came into public knowledge. An English composer named Gustav Holst, interested in the new discovery of the hymn to Jesus from the text in a manuscript published in 1897, he created an orchestral suite based on the hymn. In performance, it features 2 choirs, one representing Jesus and his disciples, the other the initiate, who is encircled by the first choir while they engage him or her in a question and answer dialogue. It was first performed in London in 1920 and was reportedly an outstanding success. And I'll just play you a little bit of it here. Come back to the Acts of John in our chat. For now, let's move on to some other texts. We'll begin with the Acts of Peter. It's maybe the earliest of the Apocryphal Acts, written, again, sometime in the late 2nd or early 3rd century. But as with the Acts of John, we don't have the complete text. We only have, again, about 2/3 of it. Let me just go through the various sources we have and give you some sense of the complexity of the problems trying to reconstruct these texts. So the sources include a story of Peter and his virgin daughter from a Coptic manuscript, pictured here. Now, it's also mentioned by Augustine and shows up in a text called the Acts of Nereus and Achilles. It's not clear if it belonged to the Acts of Peter or not, so scholars are divided on that issue. And in the story, Peter is healing. There's a crowd around him, and someone asks him, "Why have you not healed your virgin daughter?" The person asked says, "Her whose one side is wholly paralyzed, and she lies there in that corner disabled." Peter heals her just to show that God is not powerless concerning anything we ask of him. And then he says, "Go to your place, sit down, and return to your infirmity, for this is beneficial for you and for me." So she's paralyzed again. Peter says he had a vision when his daughter was born that she would harm many souls if her body remains healthy. When she was 10, a rich man named Ptolemy wanted to take her as his wife. Then 2 pages are missing in the text, but it resumes with Ptolemy apparently taking her to his house. and that at his house she became paralyzed due to a prayer from her father. Ptolemy drops her on Peter's doorstep. He no longer needs her if she's paralyzed. And Peter says, "We took her in, praising the Lord who had saved his servant from defilement, pollution, and destruction. This is why the girl remains in the same condition to this day." Ptolemy is repentant in the text and cries so much he goes blind. He was going to hang himself, but a vision told him to go to Peter's house. There he is healed and goes on to become a philanthropist and gives some land to Peter's daughter. Peter sold the land and gave the money to the poor. This is a terrible story. Peter's daughter is going to be a temptation. This horrible man takes her and wants to have sex with her, but Peter prays so that she's paralyzed so that he can't have sex with her. Ptolemy is repentant and is forgiven, and Peter's daughter stays paralyzed for the rest of her life, only occasionally given her ability to move back when Peter feels like he wants to make an example of her. The rest of the Acts of Peter is found primarily in a Latin translation from the 6th century in a manuscript we call the Actus Virgilensis. Problem with this, because it's a Latin translation, it's not the original Greek, and it's a bit late, it seems to preserve interests that are not original to the text. Only the martyrdom section in it actually contains anything relating to the issue of celibacy that's usually prominent in the Apocryphal Acts. The remainder deals with the theme of repentance and forgiveness. So it's perhaps composed, or if not the text was composed, this version, this Latin version, was created from the original after a time of persecution when lapsed Christians, wished to rejoin the community. So these lapsi, in order to avoid being persecuted, either compromised the Christian faith by offering sacrifices to idols, or offered sacrifices to the Roman emperor, or obtained a certificate saying that they offered a sacrifice to the Roman emperor. These are called libellatici. And here's an example here found in Oxyrhynchus in Egypt. They could also escape prosecution as a Christian by giving up copies of the sacred scriptures to the secular authorities in order for them to be burned. So some of the church said that lapsi should not be allowed back into the community after they had confessed to not being Christians. Acts of Peter seems to say, yes, they can. We see this theme as early as the first story in the text, which is actually about Paul, and it's not in the assigned text that I had you read for today. So in this story, Paul is in Rome, and he's about to depart for Spain. A woman named Rufina appears to her to receive the Eucharist, but she came to Paul after having slept with an adulterer. As a result, she collapses and is paralyzed on her left side. It's promised that if she repents, she will be forgiven. The people saw this, remembered their own sins, and they say, "We do not know whether God forgives us the former sins which we have committed." Paul then promises he will forgive them and uses himself as an example as one who was a blasphemer and a persecutor earlier in his life. This is a great example of the anxieties of the lapsi. They too are sinners wishing to return, wondering if their sins will be forgiven. Even Paul is a former sinner, and Paul represents the church, willing to forgive the lapsi if they repent. So there's lots of other stories in the Acts of Peter which has the same theme of repentance and forgiveness. Let's mention a few other sources for the text. We have a fragment from Oxyrhynchus. This covers chapters 25 to 26 in the Actus Virgilensis. So here we have it in Greek. It's not much different from that portion of the text, unfortunately. We also have the Martyrdom of Peter. Again, this is one of these martyrdoms that's circulated by itself. We have three Greek manuscripts of the Martyrdom of Peter. And it also has a few portions that are found in the Actus Virgilensis as well. So we have some material that overlaps in the Greek and the Latin. And another curious source is a text called The Life of Eburcius. This is a 4th century text celebrating the life of the 2nd century bishop of Hierapolis. And it preserves parts of the speeches from Acts of Peter. So what we see in the Actus Virgilensis as speeches of Peter are taken out and put into this Life of Eburcius. So it's a bizarre kind of source here. In the mouth of Eburcius, however, the speeches are directed against Marcionites in the guise of Simon's disciples. good thing about Burkius is that the speeches here are in Greek. So we have a witness to the Greek speeches of Peter from the original Greek Acts of Peter that are in parallel to the versions in Latin we find in Actus Virgilensis. So it helps us reconstruct what these original speeches were. So as I said, these things can be complicated to reconstruct. The stories of the Acts of Peter were reused by a number of later writers. There's not enough time to describe them in any detail here, but I just want to demonstrate that the creation of Acts of Peter continued even after the settling of the canon in the 4th century. A few of these have been featured in the two more New Testament Apocrypha volumes, one that's already been published and one that's in preparation, and a few were assigned for the Eclavis project. So we have a Passion of Peter attributed to Linus. We have the Acts of Nereus and Achilleus. These are later followers of Peter. Acts of Peter and Paul, and the Passion of Peter and Paul, attributed to Marcellus. On the Ruin of the City of Jerusalem by Pseudo-Hegesippus, which talks about conflicts between Simon, Magus, and Peter. The Syriac History of Simon Cephas, which draws upon the Acts of Peter. The Syriac Preaching of Simon Cephas in the City of Rome. And the Acts of Xanthippe and Polyxena, which also has elements of the Simon and Peter, Simon Magus and Simon Peter battle. I'm going to show you also two examples of the Acts of Peter being used as a source in modern culture, and early modern culture at that. We're used to seeing Apocrypha show up in things like the Da Vinci Code, but people have been drawing on Apocrypha for decades. The first is from the 1954 film The Silver Chalice. This is based on a 1952 novel by Thomas B. Costain. According to the story in the novel, a Greek artisan is commissioned to cast the cup of Christ in silver and sculpt around its rim the faces of the apostles and Jesus himself. So the artisan travels to Jerusalem and eventually to Rome to complete the task. Early in the novel, around chapter 9, we are introduced to Simon Magus. Simon is being used by the Sanhedrin in the text to produce doubt about the miracles of Jesus. So if Simon can duplicate the miracles of Jesus through trickery, then Jesus cannot be the Messiah. Things go wrong when Simon starts to believe he does have magical powers. In the scene from the novel, Simon entertains Nero and requests an opportunity for a public miracle contest with Peter. In the Petrian Apocrypha, the two compete several times, both in Rome and Palestine. But in the Silver Chalice, Peter and Simon never meet, because in the novel, Peter says the Lord had not instructed him to do so. Peter believes Simon will defeat himself, and he does. Recalling a scene from the Acts of Peter 32, Simon launches himself from a tower to demonstrate his ability to fly, but instead falls to his death. In the Acts of Peter, however, Peter prays for Simon to fall and become crippled, and Simon later dies of his injury. So here's a clip from the film.
I did not come to the center of the world to be a peddler of tricks. My time of greatness is at hand.
No one dares be great in Rome except Nero. He is God, not you. And remember, Nero is a jealous God.
Simon.
Yes, Caesar.
What new illusions have you to show us?
Oh, Caesar. I have words in mind rather than tricks. Words of a new wonder for your learned ear. Meanwhile, Caesar, my hands. Do not forget their trade.
Oh!
Simon. Now you have my permission to speak the words you wanted me to hear. Words of a new wonder, you said.
Oh, Caesar, there is a test I desire to make, a test of power. Match me, O Caesar, like the gladiators in the arena against the leader of the Christians. And you be the judge as to which of us can work the greater wonders.
A match against the Christians. What do you say, Tigellinus?
You might find it amusing, Caesar. Simon against the Christians.
It would be a change from the lions.
Their acknowledged leader is here in Rome. He is called Peter. It is said wherever his shadow falls, the sick become well and the lame walk. Summon him before you, Caesar, to give proof of his powers. And I will give proof of mine.
You have my consent, Simon. These Christians are becoming too numerous. They are hiding all around us. By all means, let us bring them out of their holes. Find this man Peter and bring him before me.
Caesar be praised.
Tell me, Simon, what of this contest with the Christians?
Oh, Caesar, I am ready. But your guards have been unable to find Peter. But with Caesar's gracious permission, I will perform a miracle such as their own Jesus could not do.
What is it you propose?
I will fly. So?
Well, no man has ever flown. Even gods. Even I might find it difficult.
Oh, Caesar. It is only by the inspiration of your divine presence and by the power of your will that I can do this miracle.
Well, in that case, I promise to smile upon your effort.
Then let me build a tower, O Caesar, higher than any building in Rome. And let me build it with Christians who infest the capital of the ruler of the world. When they see me fly high over Rome with no wings to support me, they will turn away from Peter as a false leader and from Jesus as a false god.
Build your tower, Simon, and build it here in the gardens of my palace. And do it quickly. Work day and night. Spare no slaves and no Christians. Until it is ready.
Caesar be praised.
Yes, gracious lady.
Did you hear the crowd when I came in? Hail Simon, they shouted. They sense the moment of my greatness and are ready to accept me.
Share your greatness with Caesar and give him the lion's share.
I need no wires, no buckles. I need no wheel to be turned. I shall fly by the power of my own will, and all the world will wonder and worship.
Are you out of your mind?
There's no need to worry, my Helena. You do not know what manner of man I am today. For I am no longer man. I am God.
Nice. Hymen. Fly in the name of Caesar and to his everlasting glory.
The second clip is from Quo Vadis, a film from 1951. It's based on the 1896 novel Quo Vadis, A Narrative of the Time of Nero, released in 1896 by Polish writer Henryk Sienkiewicz. The title is Latin for Where Are You Going, Lord? And is an allusion to an episode from the Acts of Peter 35. The novel takes place in the year 64 and tells the love story of a young Christian woman, Lygia, and Marcus Vinicius, a Roman patrician. When the two are in prison, they meet Peter, who performs their marriage ceremony. Late in the story, there is a series of chapters telling Peter's martyrdom. In chapter 70, Peter is urged to leave Rome for his own safety, but along the way he passes Jesus. Peter asks Jesus why he's going to Rome, and he says, "Are you deserting my people? I go to Rome to be crucified a second time." Peter is thus convinced that he must head back to the city and face martyrdom. This is, again, taken from an episode from Acts of Peter 35, so it's fairly famous. But here's the clip from the film.
I think it's going to rain. You'd better look for a place to take shelter. Peter, don't you think so? What troubles you? You've hardly said anything all morning.
Oh, I'm sorry, Nazarius.
Are you very tired?
Oh, my mind is as heavy as my body. There is something wrong. With our people, perhaps. I do not know. It is at such times I need our Lord's counsel. There is within me a decision that I cannot find. If only he would speak to me, I... Look, those treetops there, they do not bend with the wind.
Yes, that is so.
And that sudden brightness coming. Do you see it, Nazarius? It is the light of the Lord. I have seen it. Christ Jesus, you are here. What is wrong, O Lord? What should I do? I am weary. How should I follow thee now? Quo vadis, Domine? Whither goest thou, Lord?
My people in Rome have need of thee.
What did you say, Nazarius?
My people in Rome have need of thee. If thou desert my people, I shall go to Rome to be crucified a second time.
Nazarius, blessed child, speak on. Speak!
Oh, Peter, you've stumbled. Here.
The words you said, say them again.
I didn't say anything.
You said, if thou desert my people, I shall go to Rome to be crucified a second time.
But I said nothing.
Yes. He has again spoken to me. Come, Nazarius.
Where are you going?
To Rome.
The final text that we're going to look at today is the Pseudo-Clementine Romance, a very interesting but neglected text. It's quite lengthy, and it hasn't been translated into English in over a century. So scholars work on it, but it's not very accessible to the broader range of scholars and to the wider public. The sources for the text are quite complicated, and scholars have yet to reach consensus on how they relate to each other and how they originated. There are two main versions. One's called the Homilies, which is a collection of 20 sermons of Peter in two Greek manuscripts. And then we have the Recognitions, a 10-book narrative translated into Latin by Rufinus of Aquila around 407 CE. There's over 100 manuscripts of this Latin version. The two go back to a common source. And this common source is Jewish-Christian in origin and was written probably in Syria in the 3rd century. It's best to read the homilies and recognitions in parallel, like we do with the Synoptic Gospels. So sometimes they overlap in content, sometimes they don't. But together we use all of them to kind of reconstruct the content of the text. Also important are two Syriac manuscripts, one dating to 411, covering recognitions 1 to 3 and homilies 10 to 17, along with an Armenian translation and three summaries, two in Greek and one in Arabic. The homilies is introduced with the letter from Peter to James and a letter from Clement to James. In the letter, Clement informs James that Peter has died and that Clement has been appointed his successor as the Bishop of Rome. Attached to the letter is what's called Clement's Epitome of the Popular Sermons of Peter, which forms the bulk of the text. Like the Apocryphal Acts, the story is a vehicle for the theology of the author and his community, which is put into the mouth of Peter in his lengthy speeches that are delivered in philosophical contests with Simon Magus. So here, Peter and Simon Magus don't have miracle contests, so who can raise someone to life or who can fly or whatever, but they have philosophical contests, and these can be quite lengthy and quite dull and pedantic. One section of the text, this is Recognitions 1, 27 to 71, has been identified as an early Jewish Christian telling of salvation history, running from the patriarchs to Jesus, written around the middle of the second century. It may have been called the Ascents of James, a text composed by the Ebionites, an early Jewish Christian group. According to Epiphanius, the Ebionites circulated trumped-up charges of evil-doing and deceit against Paul. They say that he was a Greek, the son of a Greek mother and a Greek father, that he went up to Jerusalem and remained there for a time, and that he desired to marry the daughter of the priest, and that on account of this he became a proselyte and was circumcised, and that he was angry when he could not marry such a maiden, and that he wrote against circumcision and against the Sabbath and the Mosaic law. So the Ebionites seem to really not like Paul. So a Jewish Christian group that did not like Paul, who was a Gentile, a missionary to the Gentiles. And we see some elements of that whole story that Epiphanius is talking about here within the recognition. So the recognitions may be drawing upon this earlier text. We may see some other anti-Pauline elements in the text. Pseudo-Clement's depiction of Simon Magus bears some alarming similarities to the Apostle Paul. In one of Peter's disputes with the villain, Peter diminishes Simon's authority, which, as with Paul, as we know from Galatians in the book of Acts, was granted to him in a vision. Peter asks, "Can anyone be made competent to teach through a vision? And if your opinion is that is possible, why then did our teacher spend a whole year with us who were awake? But if you were visited by him for the space of an hour and were instructed by him and thereby have become an apostle, then proclaim his words, expound what he has taught, be a friend to his apostles, and do not contend with me, who am his confidant. For you have in hostility withstood me, who am a firm rock, the foundation stone of the church." So we have a few other examples of this kind of polemic against Simon, which also could be used as polemic against Paul. So scholars have thought, well, maybe there's some kind of really a veiled criticism of Paul here, like we find in the material that Epiphanius talks about, that when we see Simon being criticized by Peter here, it's really Paul being criticized by Peter. So we have this contest between Peter and Paul. So in Pseudo-Clement, we have perhaps a text by Jewish Christian Ebionites who strongly identify with Peter, and he used this text in part to cast aspersions on Paul. This is another example of using the apostles as characters in the text to argue against the Christian groups who identify with them. We have seen this numerous times in our course already, particularly in the Gospel of Thomas and the Gospel of Mary, where we see slanders against Peter as attacks on patriarchal Orthodox Christianity. Peter is one of those figures that numerous early Christian groups seem to like very much. Everyone seems to claim him as their patron apostle, so it can get confusing trying to figure out which group's views are reflected in the text. In Pseudo-Clement, it is Jewish Christians who identify with Peter, but in other texts, Peter is connected with Roman Orthodox Gentile Christianity. So that concludes this lecture on Apocryphal Acts. We'll discuss the content of the text in a bit more detail in our chat on Tuesday night, so please try to have them read. You at least have had to read Acts of Thecla for your assignment, so we'll go into that in some detail. But also we'll talk about the others as much as we can in the time we have allotted to us. And also we'll spend some time on the course in general, see if you have any concerns about how we are conducting the last few weeks of the course. and on any of the assignments. So come prepared. So we'll talk soon.